So a big issue in the study of rock music has been the issue of scale. And by scale, I just mean the set of pitch classes from which the notes of a melody or a song are drawn. And people have talked about a variety of scales in relation to rock. People have talked about classical major and minor scales. They've talked about diatonic modes, pentatonic scales, the blues scales. But many rock songs don't adhere convincingly to any of these scales. And in this talk, I'm going to talk about an aspect of the rock style that connects with the issue of scales in an interesting way. So let's listen to this excerpt from a well-known song, the Rolling Stones' I Can't Get No Satisfaction. Let's think about the set of scale degrees that this melody uses. So we have 3, 5, flat 7, 6 in the first phrase, and then we have adding in 1, flat 3, and 2 in the second phrase. And I threw in 4 also, which comes in just a little bit later. So you have this 8-note set, 8-pitch class set. And this is actually the set of scale degrees for the entire song. And you can see that this set does not fit any conventional scale or mode. You could describe it maybe as E Mixolydian with flat 3 added, or E Dorian with major 3 added. But it's not equivalent to any conventional scale. And clearly what's problematic is the combination of 3 and flat 3. No conventional scale contains both of these degrees. I don't know if you can see that very bottom bit, but so we could explain the use of 3 and flat 3 in harmonic terms. So the accompaniment harmony in the first two measures is E major, which requires a major 3. And in the second two measures, it's A major. So adding a flat 3 onto that produces a major minor seventh chord, or as some would call it, a dominant seventh chord. Well, this explains the verse, but what about the chorus? I don't know if you can hear it, but there is actually a major triad going on in the guitar part there, a major tonic triad. And yet the melody is still using flat 3. So we have the melody using 3 over a major 1 chord in the verse, but flat 3 over a major 1 chord in the chorus. So what's going on here? Just as an aside, I should say that the transcriptions in this talk are all my own, ones that I did by ear. But they were checked by my collaborator, Trevor DeClercq. There are sometimes judgment calls in these things. You may have noticed that the singer actually sort of scoops up to that first note. Most of the cases of 3 and flat 3 in this talk, I think, are fairly clear cut. You do occasionally find notes that really seem to fall between the cracks, so-called blue notes, and I'll return to that issue later. So in this talk, I'm going to put forth a theory of the use of 3 and flat 3 in rock. And I'm going to argue that the choice between these two degrees is affected by several factors: melodic, harmonic, formal, and expressive. And these factors can interact in complex ways, so sometimes they support each other, sometimes they conflict. And this gives the scale structures in rock a kind of flexibility that I don't think is like anything that we see in common practice music. And this issue also connects with the issue of the major-minor distinction in rock, which has been somewhat controversial. So let's start with some corpus evidence. How frequent is the mixing of 3 and flat 3 in rock? Well, I have an ongoing corpus project that some of you probably know about with Trevor DeClercq, our recent graduate who's now at Middle Tennessee State University. And we've transcribed the harmony and melody of 200 rock songs. We took them from a list in Rolling Stone magazine of the 500 greatest songs of all time. And this corpus spans roughly 1950 to 2000. And it basically covers a broad spectrum of late 20th century popular music. It's got 1950s rock and roll, Motown, soul, heavy metal, 1980s synth pop, soft rock, and all kinds of other things. So you could say it covers a very broad definition of what we might consider to be rock. And this corpus data sheds some interesting light on the mixing of 3 and flat 3 in rock melodies. So here's the overall scale degree distribution of the melodies. This doesn't tell us too much in itself. It's lumping all of the songs together without attempting to categorize them as major or minor or anything else. So Trevor and I wanted to know if we simply group the melodies together in a purely statistical way, what kind of a categorization would you find? And so we took the scale degree distributions of all 200 songs, actually only 194 because 6 of them had no melody. And we used this statistical clustering technique to group these distributions together into 2 categories. And what this does is it finds the best way of sorting the melodies into 2 categories such that melodies within the same category have similar distributions. And our aim was partly to see if we would get just something like resembling a major and minor categorization just out of this purely statistical process. So here are the results. This shows the overall scale degree distributions for the 2 clusters. I just call them C1 and C2. Obviously, the computer doesn't know what to call them. So the red cluster looks a lot like major, doesn't it? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Those 7 degrees have much higher values than the remaining 5 degrees. Within that, the 5 degrees of the pentatonic scale have the most, the highest values, which is sort of interesting. But clearly, that one's very much like major mode. The blue cluster is a little harder to characterize. You could call it a kind of minor. So flat 3 is much more common than 3, but 3 is still fairly frequent. And this right away suggests that there's a fair amount of mixing of 3 and flat 3 in rock melodies. It's also interesting that 6 is much more common than flat 6, and flat 7 is much more common than raised 7, whereas in classical minor, the reverse is true, right? In classical minor, flat 6 is much more common than 6, and the leading tone is more common than the flat 7th. But that's another issue. So the data that I just showed is for the melodies of rock songs. And we did something similar for the harmonic progressions of the songs. We analyzed all the songs in Roman numeral notation. And then we took each Roman numeral to imply one instance of each chord tone that it contains. So a 1 chord implies a 1, a 3, and a 5. And this just gives you a little example. So you can take this progression, extract the scale degrees from it, and then you get a distribution like this. And we applied the same clustering process to that. And again, we got something that looks quite a bit like a major versus minor clustering. But what's interesting is comparing the harmonic clustering and the melodic clustering. So you can see that most of the songs are either melodically and harmonically major or melodically and harmonically minor. But there's quite a number of songs that are melodically minor and harmonically major, right? So they're falling into the minor melodic category, but the major harmonic one, which suggests that perhaps they're using predominantly flat 3 in the melody, but major 3 in the harmony. And actually, it's very easy to find examples of this. Here's a famous one. I buy you a diamond ring, my friend, if that makes you feel all right. So again, it's not so easy to hear the accompaniment, but it's playing a C major chord, or maybe C diamond 7th. But the melody is using the flat 3 degree. And there are lots of songs like that in rock. So this mixing of flat 3 in the melody with major 3 in the accompaniment is an important aspect of rock. But my focus on this talk is really on the combination of 3 and flat 3 within the melody itself. And what I'm going to present is a kind of theory of mediant mixture in rock. We've seen that there's quite a bit of combining 3 and flat 3 within rock melodies. And this satisfaction example that I showed suggested that it's not simply a matter of following the harmony, right? There's more to it than that. And of course, there are many rock songs that use either three or flat three consistently throughout. But there are also many melodies that mix them. And the question I'm going to address is, when both of these degrees are being used in a melody, what are the factors that determine the choice of one degree or the other at specific points? So here are three melodies that use both three and flat three. And I'd just like you to think about why three is used at some points and flat three at others. So one thing you might notice is that three is generally used in proximity to five, and flat three is generally used in proximity to one. So anywhere you have a five, there tends to be a three in the neighborhood. Anywhere you have a one, you tend to see flat three. The clearest example is the Beatles song where, oh, you can't see it behind the piano, but you have both one and five simultaneously, one in the top part and five in the bottom part. But the top part is using flat three and the bottom part is using raised three. And this proves to be a very common tendency in rock. There's a lot of other examples I could cite. Flat three tends to be used in proximity to one and three in proximity to five. And this is kind of a curious thing. It could simply be a matter of interval size. A minor third is easier to sing than a major third. But it could also reflect the influence of pentatonic scale. So notice that in pentatonic terms, three is actually a neighbor to five in the major pentatonic scale. And flat three is a neighbor to one in the minor pentatonic scale. So you could say these melodies reflect neighbor motion in pentatonic terms. Although actually very often the flat three to one motion is filled in with two. And from a Schenkerian perspective, if you like that sort of thing. And not everyone approves of applying Schenkerian theory to popular music, but some people do. You could say that a five tends to be elaborated by three or prolonged by three, whereas one tends to be prolonged by flat three. By this view also, the melodies reflect mixture of the major and minor pentatonic scales. And I think pentatonic mixture is an important aspect of rock melodies that hasn't been looked at very much. Trevor and I have argued that this minor cluster in our melodic cluster analysis that I showed earlier could be explained as a mixture or a union of the two pentatonic scales. So if you put together the 5 degrees of major pentatonic and the 5 degrees of minor, you get this 8-note scale, which is essentially the eight most frequent degrees in the minor cluster. So, melodic tendency is an important factor in the choice between flat three and three. But it's not the whole story. So let's listen to this satisfaction example once more from the verse. So this does follow the usual melodic tendencies, right? We have three in the neighborhood of five, and we have flat three in the neighborhood of one. But surely harmony is a factor as well. And in particular, it would sound strange, you know, to use that raised three over the four chord, somehow using the lowered third degree seems much more characteristic of rock. So, clearly, harmony plays a role in the choices between three and flat three, sometimes in obvious ways and sometimes in more subtle ways. A couple of straightforward examples. Here's a Nirvana song, and just pay attention to the occurrences of three and flat three and the harmony that's happening at each point.
I'll need a lizard friend. I'll deal with her into now. I'll deal. Thank you for the show.
So we see flat 3 used over a minor 1 chord and over the flat 3 triad. Then we see 3 over the 6th chord, and again here, and then 3 over the major 1 chord, and then finally flat 3 over the flat 6. So in each case, the degree is used that fits the underlying triad. There's also a very strong tendency for flat 3 to be used over 4. We saw this in satisfaction, and this tendency actually goes back to the very earliest years of rock.
Maybelline, why can't you be true? Oh, Maybelline, why can't you be true?
And this probably also explains this first flat 3, which you could think of as anticipating the 4 chord that happens in the next measure. And things like that happen quite a bit. I think this also explains A Hard Day's Night, which has always puzzled me, because in A Hard Day's Night, generally, the raised 3 is used throughout the whole verse. But then at the end, ends on the flat 3. And I always wondered about that. And I think it's simply held over from the flat 3 over the 4 chord, right? It's much more natural to use the flat 3 over 4, and rather than going, that would be a bit jarring. So he just holds on to the flat 3. That's my explanation anyway. You might think that this shows an avoidance of using 3 and flat 3 in very close proximity, but as we'll see, that's not really the case. Here's a couple more examples of the effect of harmony on mediant choices. So think about what explains the use of 3 and flat 3 in this case.
Sundown, you better take care if I find you've been creeping around my back stairs.
And another one. So in both of these cases, you have flat 3 used over a flat 7 chord. And it seems right. I mean, it would seem strange to use major 3 in that first example. But why? I mean, the flat 3 is not part of the flat 7 chord. But you could posit a kind of tonicization, which might seem odd. And I'm not really suggesting that flat 7 is tonicized in the sense of seeming like a temporary tonic, but maybe it sort of imposes its own scale briefly, its own major scale. And flat 3 is, of course, part of the scale of flat 7, and the raised 3 is not. So that's the best explanation I can come up with. I'd be interested to know if you have an alternative explanation. So we've looked at the influence of melodic tendency and the influence of harmony. But there are still other factors that may play a role. So here's an extended example from Nickelback's How You Remind Me. And for the most part, flat 3 is used. But at one point, there's a very prominent raised 3. And think about why the major 3 is used at this one particular point. And then it goes back to flat 3. So well, the point where 3 is used is the end of the verse, or it's a little bit ambiguous whether that's the verse, but the end of a section, the end of a formal section. So arguably a cadence. And it's common for melodies to switch from flat 3 to 3 at cadential points. Here's another example from She's Not There by the Zombies. This is, in this case, the shift is not in the main melody, but rather in the backing vocal.
Well, let me tell you about the way she looked, the way she had said the color of her hair. Her voice was soft and cool, her eyes were clear and bright, but she's not there.
So, of course, this is familiar to us from common practice theory. What do we call it in common practice theory? Huh? Picardy third. Thank you, Betsy. It's similar to a common device that it's well known to us from classical music. So we often find, actually, that going back to the Renaissance even, in a minor key or minor mode, piece very often will end with a major tonic chord. And possibly its use in rock is due to classical influence. But it may also have arisen independently. Of course, the major triad is inherently more stable than the minor triad because of its basis in the overtone series. So it naturally forms a more satisfying cadential harmony. So one final factor in choices between 3 and flat 3 is the expressive factor. And it's well known that major is happy and minor is sad. This is kind of a cliche, but actually it's a huge part of what makes tonal music expressive. While as we've seen, the major-minor key dichotomy doesn't apply to rock in quite the same way as in classical music, it's clear that modern listeners are still sensitive to these emotional connotations. My work that I've done with Daphne Tan on emotional connotations of diatonic modes has shown that modes with a major third have more positive connotations than those with a minor third. And since, of course, 3 and flat 3 are the primary indicators of major and minor, they're a powerful tool for signaling expressive shifts, as, of course, we see that all the time in Schubert's Lieder and all kinds of other common practice music. But we see it sometimes in rock as well. And this is a nice example. So this song is basically a tirade against an ex-lover. And the mood is mostly a very angry, which is fittingly represented by the flat threes. But the beginning of this chorus is kind of a joyful moment. It's on the words, and I'm here, which I take it as partly kind of she's celebrating her survival, that she got through this breakup. But also, she's confronting her ex in the middle of dinner. It's such a great line. Did you forget about me, Mr. Duplicity? I hate to bug you in the middle of dinner. It just evokes the whole scene of this guy out with his new girlfriend, and she barges in and starts berating him. At that point, the melody momentarily moves to 3. So consistently flat 3 until we get to we're seeing A's until we get to the beginning of the chorus, and I'm here, and then we get that A sharp. And then what's interesting about this? This is an interesting moment. I said a moment ago that normally we see the lower third over the flat 7 degree. But here we see the major third. And I think that's, again, a sort of expressive thing. It's sort of capturing the awkwardness of the moment, at least the awkward from his point of view. The kind of incongruity or just the whole sort of uncomfortable aspect of the moment to have this sort of jarring raise 3 over a flat 7 chord. Here's another very recent song that was all the rage a year or two ago, or even less, a year ago maybe. So Royals, this on the surface, this song is about not having an upper class lifestyle and not needing one. So that kind of lux just ain't for us. We crave a different kind of buzz. So the implication there is we don't have a royal lifestyle, and we get our kicks in other ways. And it's mostly a upbeat song and uses three almost exclusively, and actually in a couple of unusual ways. So in this point, we have three over a four chord, which as we've seen is unusual, right? Most often over a four, we'll have the lowered three.
But every song's like gold teeth, gray goose dripping in the bathroom, bloodstains, ball gowns, trash in the hotel room. We don't care. We're driving Cadillacs in our dreams. But everybody's.
So that's a little bit unusual. More typical would be. Right? But she goes. And then at another point, we see a 3 over a flat 7. And again, that's unusual.
And we'll never be royals. It's the one in our blood. That kind of lux just ain't for us. We crave a different kind of bud.
But there are hints of ambivalence in the lyrics. So that line, we're driving Cadillacs in our dreams, suggests, well, she is actually sort of dreaming of this royal lifestyle. Maybe she does crave it. And at the end of the chorus, that comes out musically as the melody shifts to flat three on the line, let me live that fantasy. You know, I can't have the royal lifestyle for real, so let me at least fantasize about it.
Let me be your ruler. You can call me Queen Bee. And baby, I'll rule. Let me live that fantasy.
And the shift is made more striking by the fact that three has been used so consistently up to that point. So perhaps we can explain those unusual threes that I mentioned earlier as kind of heightening the contrast with the flat three that occurs at the end of the chorus. So the issue of scale that I said I was going to touch on, I've sort of been evading it a little bit. I've been talking about rock musicians making choices between three and flat three, and there's sort of an implication there that you either use one or the other, that they're in a sort of complementary distribution. And of course, the labels three and flat three suggest that also. That suggests that there are two variants of the same underlying thing, and you have to sort of choose between them. And in terms of conventional scales, that makes sense, right, as we discussed, because no diatonic mode contains both three and flat three. So you might say that when a singer shifts from one to the other, they're shifting the underlying, they're simply shifting from one diatonic mode to another. But it's also possible that the 2 degrees are present in the same scale. It's not obvious what that scale is, but maybe this pentatonic union scale that I talked about. 1, 2, flat 3, 3, 4, 5, 6, flat 7, which is basically Mixolydian plus flat 3 or Dorian plus raised 3. So there's two possible ways of thinking about this, thinking of moves from 3 to flat 3 as a shift in scale, or thinking about them as both being within the same scale. How can we decide between these two views? Well, it seems to me that if the shifts from 3 to flat 3 represent a shift in the underlying scale, we wouldn't expect to see very rapid alternations between them, on the reasoning that presumably it requires some effort to shift from one scale to another. And so you might expect to see 3 in one phrase and flat 3 in the next, but you wouldn't expect to see them very closely juxtaposed. Do we see such rapid alternations? Well, yes, we do. Here's an example.
When I was younger, so much younger than today,
I never needed
anybody's help in any way.
Da 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 da. Well, that's about as rapid an alternation as you could get. So you might say, well, those aren't really flat threes, those are sharp twos. Well, in that example, maybe they are, but what about this example? Let me just play that again.
You get up every morning
So if someone is going to tell me that's a D sharp, but that's an E flat, I think that's not very convincing. Suggesting, because that suggests that those are two different scale degrees, but do they really sound like two different scale degrees? It's hard for me to hear those as being fundamentally different things. So, I don't know if you buy that reasoning, but that's my reasoning. And my conclusion is that the shifts between 3 and flat 3 don't necessarily involve the shift in scale. 3 and flat 3 may very well coexist within the same scale. And it's not obvious what that scale is. Perhaps it's the pentatonic union scale that I mentioned, or something else. And I mean, I'm thinking in terms of scales cognitively, right? Because, I mean, in music cognition, we assume that scales have psychological reality, and in classical music, it's pretty obvious what those scales are. Well, actually, in minor, it's not so obvious what they are. But in major, it's very clear-cut that, you know, some notes are within the scale and some notes aren't, and there's a lot of experimental evidence for that. But in rock, it's a much less clear-cut case, so it's a real concrete psychological question to ask, what are the scale structures that are going on in the minds of rock musicians when they're performing or writing rock music? And I'm just looking for ways of getting at that. But in any case, it's clear that 3 and flat 3 do have a sort of complementary relationship. They're similar in function in the sense that they're both chord tones of 1, stable in the context of 1. Yet there are some situations that favor 3 and some that favor flat 3. So even if they are part of the same scale, it still makes sense to think of them as in a way being variants of the same thing, and also in a way as being complementary. So I propose 4 factors that affect the choice between 3 and flat 3. Melodic tendency, we prefer 3 in proximity to 5, flat 3 in proximity to 1. Harmony, we choose the degree that fits the harmony, either as a chord tone or maybe as a scale tone. So for example, preferring flat 3 over a flat 7 chord. We prefer 3 over flat 3 at cadential points. And we choose the degree that fits the mood of the moment, whereas 3 generally has positive implications and flat 3 has negative ones. And I suggested that 3 and flat 3 may well coexist within the same scale, although it's clear that they're still, in a sense, in a complementary relationship. So what we're doing here is theory. We're looking for general principles of a style. And as with any music theory, the hope is that this will inform analysis. It will help us to better understand individual pieces. So for example, I think it helped us become aware of these unusual uses of 3, such as the use of 3 over 4 and flat 7 in royals. One final issue I just want to touch on is the origins of mediant mixture in rock. Where does it come from? So some of its aspect might be traced to common practice music. Certainly, as we all know, there's modal mixture in common practice music, often involving 3 and flat 3. And I pointed to some factors in mediant mixture in rock that are actually similar to common practice phenomena. The preference for 3 at cadences, with connecting with the Picardy third, and also the expressive implications of 3 and flat 3, which very much connect with common practice music. However, other things don't. This factor of melodic tendency, I'm not aware that anyone has talked in common practice music about 3 being sort of preferred in the neighborhood of 5 and flat 3 being preferred in the neighborhood of 1. I think that's something that's unique to rock. As I said, it may be due to the role of pentatonicism. Also, of course, the practice of combining flat 3 in the melody with 3 in harmony is not something that we really see at all in common practice music. And also, just the fact that in many of these songs, 3 and flat 3 seem to be roughly equally balanced. Like Satisfaction, for example, it's very hard to say whether the melody is in major or minor. It's they're sort of almost equally balanced. And again, that's something that I think rarely occurs in common practice music. So there are some connections with common practice music, but also some differences. Now, what about the blues? That's something that you've probably been wondering about. And certainly there's a big connection here. Everyone acknowledges the importance of mediant mixture in the blues, mixing 3 and flat 3. You see it both between the melody and the harmony, somewhat similarly to the situation in rock. You see flat 3 in the melody, often combined with a major 3 in the harmony, and within the melody as well. And people have also specifically noted the influence of harmony, and especially the tendency to move to flat 3 over the 4 chord of the blues progression. So that's a very specific connection. I haven't seen mention of the other factors that I've talked about, melodic tendency, the cadential preference for 3, and the expressive implications, but I'm not an expert on the blues, so that's something that I want to look into more. And I mean, the blues in general has been neglected. It's been studied much less than pop and rock music, so that's a whole area that deserves more study. This brings us to the tricky topic of the blue note, and this is a tricky term. Some people use it just to mean the use of minor mode scale degrees in a major mode context, which is something that I've been talking about in this talk, and the term blue third is also used in that way. But there's another use of the term, which means a single note that falls between the cracks of two chromatic scale categories. And that's how I'm going to use the note, the term here. And that's something that I haven't really addressed in this talk. My impression is that it's much less common in rock than it is in the blues. Here's an example from a blues song. Listen to those guitar notes.
The gypsy woman told my mother before I was born, I got a boy child coming. He's gonna be a son of a gun. He's gonna make pretty women jump and shout. Then the world wanna know what this all about. But you know I'm here. Everybody knows.
So I would say those C's in the melody are pretty clear flat threes, but those C's in the guitar part seem to me to be right in the middle. I don't know if you hear them that way, but it's very hard for me to hear them as either clearly raised three or lower three. Let me just play the beginning once more. Just listen to those specific notes. I don't know what you think about that, but that's my hearing. So do we ever get blue notes in rock? Well, I think rather rarely, and this is about the best example that I could find. I'll play it once more, and again, think about whether those are threes or flat threes. I was born in a class by hurricane, and I howled at the morning driving rain. I think some of them are really right in the middle. Of course, some of them also change. You might start on a flat three and then scoop up to the three. In general, I would say real blue notes are pretty rare in rock. What I think we find is a mixture of fairly clear-cut threes and fairly clear-cut flat threes. And I wonder if perhaps this emerged as a way of approximating the sound of the blues within a 12-tone, the 12-step Western chromatic scale. But this is a ripe area for future research. Both in the blues and in rock, and digital signal processing could be used. I've actually just started working on this with Xiao Duan in the electrical engineering department. We're looking at that very song, actually, and doing some sound analysis of it and trying to figure out what the singer is actually doing. And there are issues of perception here. I tend to hear most of the notes that I've been talking about in this talk as fairly clear cut, but there is this phenomenon of categorical perception, right? We may tend to hear them as clear cut when they may not be. They may actually be much more of a continuum in terms of what the singers are doing. So many issues and questions to be explored. Thank you for your attention.
Fantastic, Dave. Questions, discussion? Well, I'll start it out then, just to keep the ball rolling. So the very last thing you were talking about, in the cracks of 3 and flat 3, I find that so much rock guitar playing is based on, especially the stuff that involves minor pentatonic steps, it's really based on blues technique. And it really just sort of happens that idiomatically on the guitar, where that third usually falls is on the first finger. So it's very easy for a guitarist to give that just a little bit of a bend that doesn't go all the way up to the major third from the minor third, and especially to use it at the tail end of a phrase that's heading toward the first scale. So if you're going 4 flat 3, you give it just a little bit of a pinch. And so you do actually, I think that's a fairly, almost a kind of a cliche-ish kind of guitar thing to do, but I will admit, when you look at vocal parts,
yeah,
it's a little bit different that way. So.
But then singers may start imitating what guitars do.
I think the perception thing you say at the end is really key, because what a guitarist may see as a kind of a string bend because of its physical obviousness, a singer may perceive as a kind of color, because they don't really think that they're bending them as much as they think they're just sort of shaping it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sure.
Speaking as a singer, what Satisfaction came out when?
65.
Okay, so I'm a little kid, and I grew up being a singer in choirs and stuff, and I sing along with rock and roll. And I specifically remember as a child trying to sing Satisfaction and not being sure what note to sing when it went to flat 3, and I kept trying to correct it, you know, and I thought, well, that's not what they're singing. So it's a powerful kind of enculturation thing.
Yeah.
That I would want to fix that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that proves my point that it's something that is not very different from common practice. The common practice music you were reared on, yes, presumably. I don't know if I'd be very interested to know either now or later if you agree with me about these notes, well, if you agree with any aspect of the talk, but if you agree with my transcriptions, because again, it is subjective, and I'm hoping to write a book about rock, and this will be part of it. It's in the proposal stage right now, but welcome your thoughts. But you were going to say something.
I was going to say something about the flat 3 sort of chromatic overtone. What was that song that had the...
Yeah, well, there were a couple. One was Help, and one was a Taking Care of Business. This one or the previous?
That one. No, what's the next one?
Oh, the previous one? I never needed anybody's help. Or you get up every morning.
That's that one. Okay, so to me, the first ones sound like sharp twos because they're chromatic neighbor tones.
Yeah.
But then Alarm Clock sounds like flat 3. So I don't think they have to have the same spelling or fashion.
Well, it's just, I agree. Certainly, if you saw that in a classical melody, which you might, you would label them as sharp twos. But in a classical music, you wouldn't then get E flat in the melody in the next measure. And I just think it's odd, again, cognitively, to think that those two are not the same.
I sort of believe in a mixture scale, you know. So here you're in a majorish part of the scale,
yeah,
in chromatic neighbor tones, and then you're in the mixture part of the scale. It's not like you're shifting between two scales, but there's a mixture scale, which is like your mixed pentatonic sort of.
Yeah. I don't know who's
sure. Yeah. Is there there's an E natural in the chord on the first measure, but there's no E natural in the chord on the second. So that might also, because I heard it similarly. Like I hear the flat 3 sounds perfectly fine, but I hear the flat 3 is in the second measure, excuse me. But in the first measure, the flat threes to me sharp sound like sharp twos.
Yeah, but you do get plenty of melodies where there's nothing but flat three. Nothing but flat three over one, and there it doesn't sound bad to me. I mean, it doesn't sound uncharacteristic of rock.
I do hear it this way, and for like a vocal production reason, I'm trying to figure out how to like explain it the way I'm thinking of it. But as if like I like the idea that as if the singer it has like a spoken kind of quality to it, and it seems like that's where the fact. But like that's why it is two different notes as opposed to just one. Is the
yeah.
So is it like the speaker or they're speaking on a three,
yeah.
And that three is going to change a little bit to have that kind of spoken feeling to it. I don't know. I can't quite explain how it is that I'm hearing it, but it's more. It is more that way.
Yeah, maybe so.
Spoken quality, maybe.
I mean, here too. From a Shankarian perspective, I mean, surely those flat threes would be lower chromatic neighbors, and at a higher level, that flat three would be a lower chromatic, right? It would be. That's how you would analyze it. And so, again, are we going to think of that as being
different?
What?
Rotating parallel.
Yeah. Exactly. And so it would seem odd to label them as different things. Not that I'm endorsing a
you've also got a great paper on harmonic melodic divorce, and I noticed that you don't invoke that concept at any point to separate the minor. Could it be that there are cases that are not quite divorces, not even quite legal separations, they're just kind of girls' night out, you know? the melody stratifies out, and so it really, we're not really hearing the E against the E flat in any vertical sense, they're just divorcing.
I was just thinking earlier today. I don't ever mention melodic harmonic divorce. I should have. You're quite right. There is a tendency for the melody to be often independent of the harmony. That's quite true. Yeah. Any other thoughts?
Well, maybe just one more. I don't mean to dive too much, but what you're calling expressive uses of the flat three, I might call, well, I think I would seem as expressive too, but I see a lot of stylistic reference, and I think you do too, because you talked about the blues at the end. But it seems to me that whenever somebody in rock music is using that flat third in a context where, strictly speaking, it should have been a major third, natural third, there's an immediate stylistic reference to the blues in my ear. And I think it's fairly typical for people to sort of toggle, and I think this gets to some of what you were talking about, toggle between the blues influence and the pop influence. So the pop influence would really be to have the standard third the way we think of it in common practice. And then you can add a blues touch, or it could be mostly blues with a bit of a pop touch.
Yeah.
And one of the other ones you dealt with where the flat seven went down, but you had the major third above it. And you were saying, well, this is kind of interesting. What I heard there is a jazz reference. So that when you play that flat seven chord with the natural three above it, you're really hearing a sharp 11 kind of harmony.
Yeah.
And as I recall, there were a lot of sort of vocal harmonies going on there. So it gives that kind of lushness that goes with jazz. So for me, sometimes these things are explained by sort of stylistic references. Then, of course, you'd be in a position of having to establish that in fact is a consistent practice within that style, and at least to another whole set of problems. But for me, that's the expressive moment where people are reaching out to other kinds of styles, and that helps explain it for me.
But and for you, that also carries the positive-negative associations, or it's kind of instead of that.
Yeah, it's a bit more of a toggling and a bit less of a consistent. As you look at the other model that you're positing, which I like very much, the blended major minor. That's kind of the way guitar players learn to improvise.
Yeah.
They kind of learn these scales and then they kind of play around with them.
John Henry.
I thought that was interesting what John was just mentioning. I was kind of picking away at that in my brain as you were talking too about whether there's a possible connection to jazz harmony, because I think it might be possible to see these as extensions over 1/4 and, you know, over 1/4 and 5. You know, you get 11 or sharp, this 3 or flat 3 is 11 or sharp 11 over 1, 7, major or minor 7 over 4, and 13 or flat 13 over 5. So it's a common, sort of a common extension.
You mean nine or, wait, run that by me again? Over one, three is?
I'm sorry, over one, three could be major, minor three, but minor three could also
could be sharp nine. Sharp nine, yeah.
Sharp nine, excuse me.
Yeah.
Flat seven over, flat seven or major seven over four.
Four, yeah.
And then 13 or flat 13 over
yeah.
Five.
Yeah.
True. Yeah, I mean, I guess we're all sort of coming from different different contexts, and these things can be heard in different ways, yeah.
Do you have any idea what it would look like if you took your corpus and plotted the change in these usages over the 50-year period that it spans?
Yeah, I've done that a little bit. Well, we've done that a little bit. Not very much interesting happens in terms of 3 and flat 3. You do get this very striking change in minor songs, where basically this has reversed. In the early years, in minor songs, that is ones that use predominantly flat 3, you get almost exclusively 6, no flat 6. Now you get almost exclusively flat 6 and no 6. So it's like people have shifted from Dorian to Aeolian or something like that. To natural minor, which I find very curious because that's more like classical minor. So I don't know if you've noticed this on the radio, but I have. There's a lot more natural minor being used. This is. That kind of thing. That's what you heard in the 50s and 60s. Now what you hear is. Much more Aeolian. Which I see as kind of the blues influence receding. But anyway.
Can we go back to taking care of business again?
Yeah.
I find myself, like a lot of people, made a little bit edgy about this one, maybe because I part of me feels like there's a bit of contrivance in insisting that the pitch class D sharp E flat is even the same entity in bar one and bar two.
Well, that's the issue.
Yeah. So and you were talking about a kind of a standard Shankarian reduction of this would good for that E to connect it linearly to the D sharp or E flat and back. But what if there were a kind of a way of parsing this that were focused more on sort of certain melodic affinities, kind of right on what you said earlier, that focuses not on the parsimonious linear structures, but rather picking the notes that are embellished and looking for little embellishing idioms. Because it seems to me that this melody is really about an E and a C, not about an E and an E flat slash D sharp. I hear two sort of licks strung together here. The 1, 2, 3, da 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 dum,
yeah.
That thing, and the ba da da dum,
yeah.
It's another thing.
Yeah.
And I feel like in terms of the way they're produced vocally, the way I sort of know them as independent licks, I'm not sure a person singing this would have any idea that they were the same note.
Okay, well, what about this one?
I don't have the actual vocal performance in my ear enough. Is that a smear into
the... Well, it's two syllables. So, well, let's listen to it.
It's a
return to
the opening.
So it's a D sharp. Da 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 da. It's very hard for me not to hear.
So bars 4 and 3 and 4 are in a way not the same note in terms of the way I would produce them vocally in this idiom.
Da 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 da.
Yeah. Cognitively, not the same.
All out into a scale configuration goes deeply against the grain of the way I would, the way I feel like the person who sings in this style would arrive at that melody.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you could think of a singer in this style does not say practice scales or write scales on their placement exams in a you know, conservatory program. They're not in the world of scales at all, are they? And
well, I'm not sure about Bachman or Turner or Overdrive for that matter, but yeah, you may be right.
But I mean, the idea of the idiom based approach to this, I probably wouldn't be thinking this way if you hadn't pointed out that particular affinity about melodic minor thirds. That's, I think that's pretty striking.
So in this case, if you wanted to reduce that a bit or just sort of think of the schematic, the line basically goes E counterpointed with C,
yeah, right,
and then E flat counterpointed with B flat, then counterpointed with F, and then the E flat is then seen as a kind of retardation or something, as a kind of a suspension up to the initial stable point, and the entire thing is a kind of prolongation of the C and the E with the E flat a lower neighbor.
I would even go further and have the reduction be an E going to a C and back to E. Not even invoking a kind of compound melody. I hear the two anchor points being a third apart, and that if there's a kind of the bias toward teasing out linear structures, that's against how I feel this tune. But yeah, let's just think.
Is there any meaningful relationship between 3 and flat 3 and text emphasis in any of the corpus that we looked at?
We haven't looked at that in any systematic way. That's a good question, but it would be hard to look at objectively.
Totally different question. John pointed out this ambiguity surrounding the three and flat three in the cracks seems very much a guitar and vocal idiom. Who's imitating whom, I can't say. But have you looked at all about how all this gets rendered when the poor pianist in the band has to deal with it? Because I feel like I hear a lot of mashed
sharp
twos and threes.
Sure.
A kind of, you know, triage.
That's a...
That kind of thing, yeah. Yeah.
Like, I'm wondering,
that would be
when pianist is soloing in some of these idioms, do they prefer the same kind of melodic minor thirds, say, to major thirds that...
Yeah, because they have to make a choice.
Yeah, they have to make a choice. It's always bad. That's just not on flat three, regular three, but across the spectrum.
Yeah.
There's certain people they prefer.
And now with auto-tune, that's a whole other, even with vocals, everyone's being slotted into chromatic scale categories.
That's why auto-tune sucks the life out of music.
I think so.
Well, thank you very much for that feedback. Yeah.